because it is good. Blessed are you, Adonai, who gave us the Torah of truth. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kishanu b'mitzvotav vetzivanu asafet ahamor. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us concerning the counting of the Omer. Today is 15 days, which is 2 weeks and 1 day of the Omer. May the Merciful One restore us unto the service of the Bet HaMekadesh to its place speedily in our days. Amen. Salah. Remain standing as we read from the Torah. We're going to be reading from Leviticus chapter 18, 1 through 5, then Ezekiel 18, 30 through 32, and then Ephesians 25 through 33. So it's, you want my microphone? Okay. I'm trying to steal my microphone. Leviticus 18, 1 through 5, Adonai said to Moshe, speak to the people of Israel, tell them, I am Adonai your God. You are not to engage in the activities found in the land of Egypt, where you used to live, and you are not to engage in the activities found in the land of Canaan, where I am bringing you, nor are you to live by their laws. You are to obey my rulings and laws and live accordingly. I am Adonai your God. You are to observe my laws and rulings, and if a person does them, he will have life through them. I am Adonai.
Vaydaber Adonai el Moshe lemor, daber b'nei Israel, vamartal echeem ani Adonai Eloyak. Kameasa ek eretz Mitzrayim asher yishbetem balo, tatsu umkase eretz Kanaan asher ani beri, etkem shema lo tasu, ubchotehem lo telku, et mishpatai tatsu ve'et chukotai, Tishmaru lakem bechem ani Adonai Eloheyak. Ushmartem et hayoktai ve et mishpetai asher yaase otam hadam v'chai bechem ani Adonai.
Ezekiel 18:30-32, therefore the house of Israel, I will judge each of you according to his ways, says Adonai Elohim. Repent and turn yourselves away from all your transgressions, so that they will not be a stumbling block that brings guilt upon you. Throw far away from yourselves all your crimes that you've committed, and make yourselves a new heart, a new spirit. For why should you die, house of Israel? I take no pleasure in the death of anyone who dies, says Adonai Elohim. So turn yourselves around and live.
Lakem ish kidrayu eshpot et kem beit Israel, Neum Adonai Adonai, Shibu v'chishbu mekal pish aikem v'lohim him lakem lishmecho avon hishlaku me'et lekem et chal pish aikem asher pishtem bam v'asu lakem lechabash v'ruach hakdsha v'lama tatu beit Israel kilo et potz bimot chameth num Adonai Adonai v'shpeim v'chu.
And you'll get it, it's okay. Now Ephesians chapter 5, 25 through 33. As for husbands, love your wives, just as the Messiah loved the Messianic community, indeed gave himself up on its behalf, in order to set it apart for God, making it clean through immersion in the mikvah, so to speak, in order to present the Messianic community to himself as a bride to be proud of, without a spot, wrinkle, or any such thing, but holy and without defect. This is how husbands ought to love their wives, like their own bodies. For the man who loves his wife is loving himself. Why, no one ever hated his own flesh. On the contrary, he feeds it well, takes care of it, just as the Messiah does the Messianic community, because we are parts of his body. Therefore, a man will leave his father and mother and remain with his wife, and the two will become echad, or one. There is profound truth hidden here, which I say concerns the Messiah and the Messianic community. However, the text also applies to each of you individually. Let each man love his wife as he does himself, and see that the wife respects her husband.
Hanashi echubu et nishkem kasher gan hamashiach achab et chada vaite et mafsho bada leman kadsha bidbaro echai asher tina bichta yitzat hamayim lichikam bigabot lo lead asher ein bach ketem vaamet vigdo ki ilmaan tichei kadsha umtaim ken chashin chab biim lechob et chashia ki kufam ki acha ki kao et ishto ocheb et atzmo ki meola la sene ish et saro ki imzan kakel ato kasher kaam adon et chato ki aberei kufo אנחנו מחסבו ומעצמאיו, על כן חזב איש את אבי ואתמו ודק, בשתו וחיו ושמיהם לבשר אחד, כדור חסוד חזן מאין פותר אותך המשיח, במשיח מחדה, מעול קמתם כאיש מכם חיבה את שתו, קו נפשו ושיעה, חין דעצו ויתרה את בלה.
Blessed are you, Lord, our God, King of the universe, who gave us the Torah of truth, set everlasting life in our midst. Blessed are thou, O Lord, the giver of the Torah.
Hallelujah.
You may be seated. Well, we're celebrating mothers today. We're celebrating women today. And so I was, you know, praying and seeking the Lord, and I went to the Torah portion, and I was trying to, you know, figure out how I can work this Torah portion in, and by the grace of Adonai, I have worked it in, in a roundabout way. I find that if I want to encourage women, then basically I need to speak to men. Hello? So I would like if you all can come a little closer, wherever you are. Just come a little closer, especially men. I want to be able to spit on you. I mean, Holy Ghost, come on you. I just need you to come a little bit closer, please. Just obey me. Just obey me. Or I can wait until you obey me, and we could be here for hours. Just come a little closer, please, because I find it's going to be one of the most important sermons that you're going to hear, because women need men to be what men are supposed to be. Did you hear me? Now, this is not a rag fest on men, and so the women are not going to be like, amen, amen, preach it to that man, amen. Because when Father's Day comes, guess who I'm going to speak to? I've already determined that I'm going to speak to the women on Father's Day, because in order to be a good wife, there has to be a good husband. In order to be a good husband, there has to be a good wife. And what I mean by good, I mean biblical. Now, a preacher was performing a wedding when he came to the part of the ceremony in which it was traditional to ask if anyone present knows any reason why the wedding should not proceed. The preacher asked, is there anyone who objected to this marriage? And a voice rang out through the church, I do! Quiet, said the preacher. You're the groom. You can't object. Listen, if you're going to object, that would be the time to object. If you're not going to do it, it would be before you get to the place where you're going to say, I do's and I will. So this sermon is not only for men, but it's also for young men that are looking for handmaidens of the Lord. Amen? Now, what happens is that many get married with little or no idea of what they're doing. True? We just knew that we love that person, and then we knew that we're going to start a life together. And so we come together, we say, I do and I will, and then it begins. The journey begins. It's up for the most of the first couple weeks, months, correct? Then it levels out a little bit, but then you start getting some dips, and those dips seem to concern you sometimes, but you're still so in love that you just overlook them. Everyone else has been telling you about some stuff, but you just continue on. And so we have sometimes very little understanding or idea what it is to get married. That's why I warn all the young people, please, pay attention, do some study, listen to what this sermon is about, have some counseling even before you choose a mate. You know, sometimes we choose a mate then have marriage counseling. You should have counseling before you choose a mate. Is it going to be like this? Is it going to be a quiet day? Is that what it is? Women, don't be afraid to say amen. Then we have those who have a faulty perception or a faulty view of the person that they are marrying. So we have two little marriages that are based on solid biblical foundation. It would be great that everyone within the house, everyone within the community, everyone that could proclaim to know Yeshua as their Savior, everyone that says they're a Christian would have a solid biblical foundation, but we know that doesn't happen. So as men, we need to fulfill our God-given roles in our homes toward our wives, which actually affect our children. So when I looked at Leviticus and I read Leviticus and I looked at Ezekiel and we read Ezekiel, really what it was about was leaving the laws of the land away and following Adonai's laws. And men, if you can understand something, that you are the priest, you are the leader of the house, and you are to be following the laws of Adonai, and then your wives and your children, because you are the example, will also follow it. So when I looked at Leviticus 16 and I saw that he says, get rid of those laws, lay down those laws, don't bring the laws in that you're used to in Egypt, don't even bring the laws in that you won't be used to in Cana, but just follow my laws. Can I just say this? We just need to follow God, right? The way our world is going, we certainly know we need to follow him. More than ever, we need to follow him. Now look at Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, 25 through 33 says, as for husbands, love your wives, just as the Messiah loved the Messianic community. Indeed, gave himself up on its behalf in order to set it apart for God. And we already read all of that. So what I really want to focus on is verse 25 and verse 26. There's something very powerful in 25. There's something very powerful in verse 26, and it gives us an understanding of how we are to be the man that God wants us to be. The word says in 25, 26, and 27, as for husbands, love your wives, just as the Messiah loved the Messianic community, indeed gave himself on his behalf. Let me stop here. Verse 25 tells you, as a husband, you're supposed to be your wife's savior. I'm not going to preach that today. I just want you to know that. You can be a savior. Moses was a savior, but not the ultimate savior, correct? You as a husband need to know that you are responsible as a leader to be the savior of your wife. It's an awesome responsibility. But let's look at verse 26. In order to set it apart for God, making it clean through immersion in the mikvah, so to speak. In order to present the Messianic community to himself as a bride to be proud of, without a spot, wrinkle, or any such thing, but holy and without defect. Now, if you remember, when I read the end, it says there's a mystery in here. There's something that we understand between Messiah and the Messianic community. But also, after that, he said, but it also applies to you individually. Individually how? Husband, wife. Husband, wife. He's our husband. We are his bride. You are a husband. You have a bride, or will have a bride. So I want to focus on verse 26, actually, because the word says, just as Yeshua is the sanctifier. Everyone say sanctifier. He is the sanctifier of the Kehila. He's a sanctifier of the Kohol. He's the sanctifier of the synagogue. He's the sanctifier of the community. So a husband is to be the wife's sanctifier. Now, I said this before a couple sermons back. Keep it in context. Yes, woman, here you roar. You're powerful on your own. Yahweh is your sanctifier. I get it. But we also know that there is a standard within marriage. There's a standard that the Word of God reveals to us, and it's found in Ephesians chapter 5. In Ephesians 5, 25 through 27, it talks about to sanctify. To sanctify someone or something means to set it apart from common or ordinary usage for a special purpose to make it holy. I'm going to say that again. To sanctify someone or something means to set it apart from common or ordinary usage for a special purpose to make it holy. Let me just say it this way. And again, keep me in context. Here is my wife. Before she was my wife, she was a powerful woman. She's still a powerful woman, but she was a woman on her own. Hello? Here's the thing. I'm not taking away from her powerful womanness, because her specialness is hers. She owns it. God made her special. She's a handmaid, right? But I'm looking for someone. I'm looking for someone that will be my helpmate. I'm looking for someone that will walk with me. I'm looking for someone that I feel that God has ordained for me. And guess what? The choices are there. Correct? But when I chose Gail, and I went and I chose Gail, and she chose me, yes. But when I chose Gail, what should have happened from that moment on is that I began to sanctify her, which means I now, from all the women that I've ever met and all the women in the world and all the women that have ever come across my path, I have decided to set her apart alone, to make her special. To who? To me. I have decided that what was common, because there's many women, what was ordinary, because there's many women, hello, And in fact, sometimes women outnumber men, so women start fighting everyone. Well, that's the Father's Day sermon. Ooh, let me go back. I'm pointing her to myself, special purpose. My job, according to Adonai, because when you came to Adonai and you asked him into your heart, his job now is to save you, right? He saved you. The blood has been applied to your life. Now it's his job to what? Sanctify you. He has called you. You are special to him. You have a purpose in him. You have a destiny in him, correct? Well, that same purpose and destiny that God sees the bride as a whole, as a husband, I am to see in my wife. Set her apart. Oh, you're just like every other woman. She is a woman, but she's not like every other woman. Why? Because she's my set apart woman. Hello? See, the Bible, people, things were set apart for Yahweh. And when they were set apart for Yahweh, they were set apart for his use. And many have been taken common objects or ordinary people and sanctify them or prayed over them or anointed them. And when that happens, they were sanctified and they became very special. A priest was not a priest. They were just a group of people who God chose as the Levites. Aaron was not really that special other than God chose him. Moses was not that special other than he was chosen. And then when God anoints them and then lays hands on them or chooses them, then that object or that person becomes very special. There's not another Moses, right? There's not another Elijah. There's not another Peter, another Paul, another Ruth, another Esther, right? And there's not another Gail. Set apart. Man, we have to learn this. Because we lump women all in one little grouping. But guess what? When I went to the grouping and picked Gail out, my job now has become to sanctify her, to make her special. To look at her in a different way for a special purpose. When a person is sanctified, he or she is set apart from his or her past unto her future. Abram was Abram until God changed his name. Then he was sanctified for a purpose. His past now is null and void, correct? Oh, he used his past to get to where he was, but once you've been sanctified, it's about your future. Hello? See, marriage is not about bringing your past in. Marriage is about having a future. When you say, I do and I will, it means all the past is gone. If you read the scriptures in Ephesians chapter 5, that's why a husband or a man leaves his what? Leaves his father and mother and what? Clings to his wife. It's not that you just ditch family. He's not talking about ditching family because in those days, family meant everything. And in fact, probably they even lived with the family. But the point is, what makes it say that you cling to it means that everything that that woman brings to you from the past is gone. New beginning. This has application not only to our lives with Messiah, because aren't you glad that old things have passed away? Behold, all things become new. It's the same thing. It applies in marriage. Because when a man marries a woman, he sets her apart from her past and unto a future that he has promised her. Now, there's a great disconnection that occurs in marriage because a husband and wife are disconnected from the previous relationships, and the only reason that a woman should make that switch, can I, ladies, listen to me, those who are not married, the only reason why you would ever make the switch from your parents' home to your husband's home is if your future looks better than what your parents can give you. If not, wait. Wait. Because he is to sanctify you and set you apart as unique and special. Don't run from one bad situation into another bad situation. Whatever you are in, whatever past has brought you, whatever position, wherever you are, wait for God to bring you that one that is willing to set you apart, willing to sanctify you, willing to make you special in that life. And you're starting all over again. Sanctification is a glorious term that describes the process of our growth from the moment we accepted Messiah until we enter heaven or until he returns. however long you've been married, and Gail and I don't have it all wrapped up, but she should be better today for knowing me and marrying me than when I met her. Not because of me, but because of the understanding of the Word of God that says, I am to sanctify her. Now, we're going to understand sanctification because sanctification, I said to mean to you, means a process of growth. Are you saying that I am responsible for my wife's growth? Yes. That's exactly what I'm saying. She's not responsible for her own growth? Yes, she's responsible for her own growth, but we're not talking about her individually. We're talking about her as a mate. We're not talking about a single person. We're talking about a married person. Hello? Isn't that a different dynamic? Y'all need water? You can't say amen. Is it thick? Something going on? Is it in the air? Do I need to turn the air on? Or higher? Listen, look at Yeshua. He didn't simply come to you and say, I do as your Savior, and then leave you standing at the altar. He woos you. He loves you. He let's just face it, put up with you. He deals with your attitude. He deals with your shortcomings, correct? And why does he do that? Now, again, listen to me, women. If you're thinking that I'm telling the men that you're a wreck and someone needs to help you, I'm not. And you'll have fair in June, okay? My point is that the Lord knows you. He loves you. He cares for you, correct? But he also knows what he's getting, imperfectness. Attitude, past, right? Things he has to deal with. So he didn't just come and save you and say, now, you're too much for me. Go on. No. When you love him, he loves you. And when you don't love him, he loves you. And when you're mad at him, he doesn't get mad at you. Come on. Listen, I'm talking, this is what you expect of Yeshua. This is what your wife is expecting of you, husbands. Boys, young men who are planning to get married. Listen, it's not just about picking someone, having sex, and then having children. It's about finding the one that God has for you that is fit neatly with you, that will flow with you, that you are sanctifying, that you are making special, and that you are allowing, that you are going to cause them to come to a greater place in God than they ever have. Yeshua committed himself to be with you as your sanctifier from that moment. The moment you have accepted him, he is your sanctifier. And he is to bring you from where you are to where he wants you to be. That's what Yeshua does. The Kehillah is the bride. He's preparing her for the marriage supper. She might appear before him in all her radiance. He wants her that when he comes that she will be without spot and without wrinkle. If he's taking his time because he's looking for a bride without spot and wrinkle, that means he's already chosen you as the bride with a spot and with a wrinkle. He didn't choose a bride without spot or wrinkle. He chose a bride with spot and wrinkle and then is in it for the long haul to sanctify you, to bring you to the place that every spot and every wrinkle be gone from you. You hear that? That's what some of you want to do right now. But your adulthood would not allow you to do it. This is a picture of what a husband should be doing for his wife on an ongoing basis. Sanctifying, covering, hovering, special. This has to do, men, listen, with the quality of your spiritual leadership in the home. I said this before. You can find a good man and you can find a good woman. Remember what I said? I'm not looking. I don't want my children. I don't want the ones that I love and care about just to find a good man or to find a good woman. You need to find a biblical man and a biblical woman because a biblical man and a biblical woman are good, but they're more than good. They're willing to take the lead on spiritual leadership. They're willing to come together and pray and seek God. They're willing to make two becoming one and making it very powerful as a spiritual couple who will have spiritual children. There's many a good people out there. And I'm not faulting their goodness. But when it comes to walking with those who are like you, good's not good enough. Ladies, good's not good enough. Bypass the good men. Look for the biblical one. Look for the one who's praying. Look for the one who's worshiping. Look for the one who's consistent. Look for the one who's committed. Look for the one who can hang in there. Look for the one who biblically loves their mother and father and honors their mother and father. Look for the one who biblically understands what it is to come to the house of the Lord and to worship him and to give and to tithe and to commit themselves. Look for that one. Both male and female, look for that one. That's the one that you want to link up with. You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, 14, what does it say here? It goes, for the unbelieving husband has been set aside for God by the wife. And the unbelieving wife has been set aside for God by the brother. Otherwise, your children would be unclean. But as it is, they are set aside for God. Now, just because you're a believer, the thing about being a believer is not that you say you're a believer. What that scripture is saying is that both the husband and wife have a godly influence in their home. And if you know to stand, having done all to stand, you continue to stand. And you know to follow the word of God no matter what. God looks at that and sees the sanctification happening, which means sanctification is a what? Process. That means the more you follow God and the more you're obedient to God, you're sanctifying unbelieving husbands. You're sanctifying unbelieving wives. And what's happened is your children will be called clean, which means that God is in the process of doing something powerful in your home. Not just because you call yourself a believer, it's because you live like one. An unbeliever is sanctified or set apart by the sanctifying presence of the believing partner as well as the children. Ephesians 5, 26 and 27. As for husbands, love your wives, just as the Messiah loved the Messianic community, indeed gave himself up on its behalf in order to set it apart for God, making it clean through immersion in the mikvah, so to speak. Men, you have an awesome responsibility that if you live your life the way that God wants you to live it, and you live it with relationship, and you live it with everything, and you live it with him being number one priority in your life, you will cause your wife to walk in the ways of God. You will cause your children to walk in the ways of God. And let me just say it in reverse. If your children aren't walking the ways of God and your wife is causing havoc in your home, it's because. Men say amen. Whose fault is it? Men. Come on, listen, I'm not afraid to tell you I don't have it all wrapped up. Come on. It's not wrong to say I missed it in areas. I miss it in areas. The delusion is that you think you're okay while your children are going down, while your wife is not happy. Oh, I need some water. I need. Maybe you should turn this, I don't even drink, but maybe you should turn this into wine. Hallelujah. What's Malachi chapter 4, verse 6 say? He will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. And otherwise, I will come and strike the land with complete destruction. Now look at our culture. What's the curse of our culture? Let's just be honest with ourselves. What's the curse of our culture? There's no fathers. We have a generation of children with no fathers. Living at home. And so they're going off in all kinds of wrong directions. And we ask the question, why? And the reason why is because they are no longer being sanctified by the presence of a godly father. Even the unclean child can be sanctified by the godly father. Which means if you are a godly father and your child has gone astray, eventually, because of your obedience to God and your relationship with God and because you love God and you are not compromising anything with God, that you would have it all in with God, no matter how far that child runs, your position of obedience makes the Ruach HaKodesh get that one. But when you compromise it, when you're not all in, your children won't be all in. And the sad thing is, it doesn't affect sometimes when they're little. It will affect them when they're adults. Because you still, when they're children, can say yes and no. When they're adults, it's over. Come on. You know how you are. Because there is no longer a sanctifying presence of a godly father. We can say it this way. If you don't have a relationship with Yeshua, if you don't love Yeshua with all your heart, and you do what you want to do when you want to do it, Yeshua doesn't necessarily now have the power to sanctify you. Because you've chosen to go a different way. This is a mystery within him and the church. It's also individual. But there's a requirement for sanctification. Men, it's not just because you're a man. I'm a man, therefore I'm a sanctifier. No. There's a requirement for sanctification. A husband who wants to be his wife's sanctifier, and I said in the beginning with Ephesians chapter 5:25, he first must become her savior. The pattern that the Messiah established. The goal of sanctification is to change us from something that we are into something we ought to be, so that we think differently, that we act differently, that we walk differently, that we talk differently, that we behave differently, and that we react differently. This process of transformation has to begin with death. If we're going to follow the plan of Yeshua and we're going to have to become our saviors to our wives, that means who has to die? Men, who has to die? Hello, men. I brought you closer so I could hear you. Who has to die, men? We have to die. We have to die for the sake of our wives. We have to die for the sake of our children. We have to die for the sake of our own lives. And anyone who tries to gain their life will lose their life. And those who lose their life will gain their life. You want to gain your wife, then die to yourself. You want to gain your children, then die to yourself. What does it mean to die to yourself? Give yourself over to God. Behave right, act right, walk right, talk right. Behave, react, and respond according to God. And die to yourself. And when you die to yourself, God's going to do something. We can say society and the way women are today and the way men are today and the way children are today, but he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So society can do what it wants, and it can go awry, and it can bust hell wide open, but the same principles that were 2,000 years ago, 5,000 years in the beginning of time is the same principles today, and if you work it, no matter in what society, what did God say to them? When you get to Canaan, don't bring those laws from Egypt. When you get to Canaan, don't engage in those laws of Canaan. Do my laws. He didn't take them to a spot where there were no laws. He didn't take them to a spot where there were no people. He didn't take them to a spot or remove them from a spot where they had no influence. He took them from a place where somebody influenced them. He brought them to a place where they could be influenced, because what he wants is a man to be able to stand in the midst of whatever it is, still serving, still loving, still following, still sanctifying his wife and his child. God don't have to remove you to sanctify you. He's a big God. He can sanctify you right where you are at. Listen, Yahweh, this is where we get confused sometimes. Yahweh is not into fixing you up or patching up our old sinful nature. You'll never read where he says he wants to fix you up, patch you up. What he said was, old has to go, new has to come. Die that you might live. See, we want God just to fix us. God, can you fix me? And God's like, I can't fix you. I just need to rebuild you. You need to get rid of everything that you think needs a patch here and a patch there. Lord, do something here. This is falling apart in my life. My marriage is falling apart. This is falling apart. My children, these things are all falling apart. Can you just fix it? Fix it. We always go, fix it, God. Fix it, God. God's not into fixing. God's into changing. Because fixing means what? It can break down again. Right? Put a patch on something, what happens? The patch falls off. I mean, duct tape does wonders, but after a while, it won't work anymore. If we could look into our spiritual lives, we probably would see our wives and our children and ourselves have massive duct tape all stuck everywhere on us. Because we refuse the process of transformation. The process of transformation is to die. A seed has to die in the ground, right? There's a death to something in order for life to come. So a husband is called to die to his own plans sometimes, to his own desires sometimes, so he can serve and love his wife. Well, I ain't giving up my plan. Here's the thing. If our godly plans, then in reality, if you're sanctifying your wife, they'll be her plans because your purpose is her assignment. Remember? The plans that you usually fight over are your own. Guarantee you probably most of the women wouldn't want to stop you from doing what God wants you to do, but they'll certainly want to stop you from what you want to do. Hello? Oh, man, how can I make it up to you? I'll give you all $20. Unless you're willing to die to yourself, don't expect your efforts to bring about real change in your wife. Don't come to the altar and say, Lord, change my wife. Don't come to me at my office and say, you need to pray for my wife to change because I'm going to turn it back to you. What are you doing? Are you sanctifying her? What are you doing? Because the key to changing your wife is your relationship with Yahweh. Sanctification is a process. But I want my wife to change now. Well, that's nice. God wants you to change now also. But sanctification says something needs to be changed, but it's a lifelong process that involves shedding all of our old ways and adopting new ways. Marriage is a what? Lifelong process. Unless you haven't been taught that. Marriage to you might be you find someone and you love them for a while, and if it doesn't work out, you get next. Next. That's not sanctifying. Aren't you glad God didn't do that to you? Of all the people in the world, does he really need you? I mean, really, he can look at you and say, you're not changing. You're not doing anything. He says, I'm tired of you. Next. There's plenty of people out there who don't know me. I'll find someone who wants to. He don't do that, does he? Ephesians chapter 5, 26. In order to set it apart for God, making it clean through immersion in the mikvah, so to speak. Men, if you take notes, if you haven't taken notes, now's the time to take a note. Are you ready? And if you can't take notes, I'm sure your wife will be more than happy to take these notes down for you right this now. One of my roles as pastor, you all know I'm the pastor here, right? I'm still the pastor here, right? One of my roles as pastor is to communicate the word of God to you as a representative of Yeshua. Don't have all the answers. I'm just supposed to look at the word of God and relate it to you to the best of my ability to you so that you can understand it and receive it and then take it and live with it, correct? That's my job as a what? As a pastor. Well, guess what that means? Husbands, if you never knew what your calling was, here is your calling. Your calling is the same. Your calling in your marriage, listen to me, next slide, is to function as your wife's pastor. I am Line of Judah's pastor, which involves you. But the first pastor wives that you have should be your husband. Husbands, they will not understand that unless you understand the role of the pastor. You are called to pastor your home. Listen. Young men, listen. If you don't understand what a pastor is, you need to get a hold of it because whether you preach behind a pulpit and speak to a crowd, you are still the pastor to your wife and to your children. You are supposed to be the priest of your home. We like the term priest because it sounds more powerful. You are supposed to be the priest of your home. In terms of leading your family before Yahweh. What'd the priest do? Bring sacrifices before Yahweh. What'd the priest do? Come and take the sacrifices from you and then kill it and put the blood and do whatever. Make sure that you are going to be set apart for God and bring your sacrifices before God. The priest's job was to lead you into the holy place, to lead you into relationship with God. What is your job then as a priest, as a pastor? You are to be the representative that God has given to your wife and to your children to lead them into the understanding of a relationship with God. Can they do it on their own? Certainly. Can your children find God by themselves? Certainly. I did. My mother and father weren't born again when I got born again. But here's the thing. Just because I made it through doesn't mean that what happened in my life was the right way. My father should have been the priest. My father should have been the pastor. My mother should have been the handmaid of the Lord that followed and was sanctified by my father, that the children would be clean. Well, it didn't happen to me, and I made it out. Yeah, but you're in a different generation, people. You're in a different world today. The only thing that we had to be careful with was Elvis. And some of you young people, Elvis? The only thing we had to be careful with was for going with the wind when they said that one bad word. Everybody, oh! You can't turn nothing on anymore. You can't even go to a PG movie anymore without trying to cover the eyes and the ears of your children. Even a G has those hidden things in it. It's not the same world. It's not the same society. You made it through, but your children might not. And you have to understand that we're living in the last day. In the last day, there's more deception. There's more deception because there's more Antichrist. And the Antichrist is coming to steal a generation and to capture a generation with influences and thinking processes. Men, you are your wife's pastor. If you want to take seriously your leadership and spiritual responsibility in marriage, if you want to help your wife blossom into what Yahweh has intended her to be, you have to be ready to shepherd her in the way that a pastor shepherds his flock. Women are wired to respond to loving leadership. Listen, why does your wife need you to be her sanctifier? Well, beyond the fact that we all need to grow and mature in Messiah, right? Listen, if you're sitting here thinking you know more than God, you don't need any more, the reason why your absence from the synagogue is because you got it all, you know it all, you don't know much. Beyond the fact that when you don't become her sanctifier, are you ready? Are you ready for this? Women, are you ready for this? Men, are you ready for this? If you don't sanctify your wife, she'll become your Jezebel. Jezebel became Jezebel because of Ahab. You step back from your leadership, Jezebel will rise. Come on. Women, if you find that you're operating in the spirit of Jezebel, you better repent from that. Well, that's another sermon in June, but you better repent from that. Because you know it's incorrect. And you say, but I have an Ahab. I understand that you might have an Ahab, but you better repent from Jezebel and pray that God does something to your Ahab and changes him so that he becomes the pastor of that flock. When you're married, your wife, men, you also married her history, and that is everything that made her who she was up to that time you met her and became part of her life. Listen, all of us have dated. That's why we tell young people not to date no more. Just have some courtship. Come to us. We'll tell you who to marry. That wasn't a bad thing back in those days. Isaiah waited for his wife. Okay, here she comes. Because in dating, one of the problems with dating is that people hide stuff. How many are good hiders? Because on a date, what do? You put your best foot forward. You give a good impression. Come on. You smile a lot. You're patient. You open the door. You say, I love you every once in a while. Love you, love bubbles. You're my precious. You are everything to me. You stare adoringly across the room, looking for, where is she? Anyone see my wife? Anyone see my girl? Right? You walk in and he's like, you're like, look at him. He's my man. He wants me. He was looking for me. Then after a while, what happens? You come in and he's like, oh God, there she is. I cannot even get away from her for 10 minutes. Hold on. And y'all have that look where you talk, oh, Lord. She wants something. She really wants something. You rush and get in the car. Hurry up! Open the door. Come on! Right? Gail knows. When I was dating Gail, Gail will tell you, we, Valentine's Day, which we did then because we didn't know any better, but we worked in the school. And you know, I bought like 20 gifts and hid them all through the school, and she had to do a little chase around, and she had to little this, and then a little this, and a little this. She had to go to the teachers, and they had to give her this, and she, oh. Today, I would be saying to myself, 20 dams. Man, that's a lot of money. Listen, we haven't been to McDonald's for a while. Let's just go. You know I love you. You know now I love you. Before I had to prove it to you, you just know now. I'm sticking with you, so you know I have to love you. That's a little different, right? That phone would ring. Oh, you're like, oh. Hey, babes. Hey, boo-boo. Now that phone rings. Decline. I tell her I'm busy. It can go both ways, right? Man, would that man leave me alone? Listen, it's impossible for any two people to know everything that can be known about each other's families and backgrounds before they marry. Impossible. That's why you either have to be in it for the long haul. You have to make sure that you want to be a sanctifier. You have to make sure that you want to be the savior. You have to make sure, women, that you find one that wants to be a savior, that wants to be a sanctifier. Because when all the curtains are pulled back, then your crazy uncle comes to visit. And the crazy mother that you had in check now manifests itself. Come on. Gets a little rough. We all have a dark side. Do we have dark sides here? Look, even the dark side won't let you raise your hand.
I will not raise my hand.
We all have attitudes. How many has ever had an attitude, bad attitude this week? Oh, Lord, I got more to do. This week, really? This week? How many still carry sometimes old hurts? I'm not asking you to tell me what it is, just old hurts. How many have opinions that really are, you know, are not right? You're all thinking, no, I think my opinion is completely right. You have ideas that are messed up in your head, right? Your sister that comes in that you didn't like very often. I mean, your brother and sister in church, you say, I'm going to slap her. I just hope someone slaps her one day. You know, that's an idea that's not supposed to be there. You know what I'm saying? Oh, I'm not saying I have them. I'm just saying I'm reading the room. How many come from messed up relationships? I didn't say how many have a messed up relationship. I said how many are coming from messed up relationships. Well, it's the same in church. See, this is the whole thing about, you know, we were kidding with our brother and sister that, you know, after 15 times, you'll know who we are. And then we said, well, it's been a bad week, so maybe 10 times. Here's the thing. People come to a church, and, you know, we're friendly, and we're nice, and we are. We're friendly and nice, and we've always been friendly and nice, and we continue to be friendly and nice. But we're also human beings, and we also are brothers and sisters, right? And the longer you church, just in case you, let me just warn you. When you church with us, you will notice that we're loving and kind, but we're just like normal people. We get mad at each other sometimes. We have attitudes sometimes. I know it's hard to believe. I mean, everyone ran over and hugged you. You're like, wow, this is a power. Yes, I said 5, 15, 20 times. I don't know. Just go in and take one of their pieces of chicken that they want, and we'll see what happens. Okay? I'll put you beside someone that might need a little practice of overcoming. My point is, when you go looking for a perfect church, you'll never find one. If you're looking for the perfect marriage, you'll not find one. I'm not saying looking for the perfect mate. I'm saying looking for someone who wants to serve God, love God with all their heart. Then the things that come out, you can handle with God. Correct? Hello? Listen, the purpose of this house, this synagogue, is that I'm to minister the word of God to you. I am supposed to minister that word of God, and that word of God is supposed to prune, it's supposed to convict, it's supposed to sharpen us, right? And then it changes us, like Ephesians says, washing the bride, so that like like a mikvah, they're becoming cleaner and cleaner. That's why you come to the house, so that through the conflicts and iron sharpening iron and having this situation with that brother and that sister and this sister and all those things that you're in it, listen, we're in it for the long haul. You can't get rid of me. The only way you can get rid of me is if you leave this place, because I'm stuck with you in a good way. I'm married to Adonai, and Adonai has placed me here. Therefore, anyone that comes, then I am somewhat then in relationship with you. I'm not ditching you, throwing you out for no reason. I'm not throwing you out because I'm tired of you. You don't throw away a marriage because it's not working in the way that you want it to work at that moment, because every marriage has good times and bad times, correct? But if we would walk in the way that God wants us to walk, that if you have aught against a brother and sister, then you go and fix it. He didn't say you would never have aught. He just says when you have aught, which means there will be a fight. The delusion is, I can't believe church people act this way. Why? Why can't you believe that? Because church people are just people under the grace and mercy of Adonai. Now, you might expect, because of the length of their relationship, that they might have been a little bit further along. But here's the thing. Are you letting God sanctify you? Wives, are you letting your husband sanctify you? What Yeshua does for his bride, a husband is to do for his wife. He is to become her pastor. Now, if you are not yet the pastor and your wife is listening to me, this is not the time to go home and have a big argument. Did you hear what Pastor said? Did you hear what he said? So when are you going to get that going? So that I can be better. Don't do that. Did you hear me? Don't do that. Just warning you. This is not a sermon to make you feel bad. I don't want to mind. But men, listen to me. Because you have an opportunity now to change, because you're hearing this word. And this word can either find good ground and plant itself and change you to make your wife better, or you can throw it away. But plenty of men want to be the head. If I said to you, if I start out, who wants to be the head of their home? Yes. Who wants their wives to submit? Yes, they should. Who wants children to know who's in charge? They know who's in charge. And that's good that you think that you're a head and you might be the head, because not all heads are good. And it's nice that you have brought yourself to the place where your wife submit for whatever reason why they submit. And that your children know that you are in charge. But when it comes to being the pastor in that home, too many of us are missing in action. You can be ahead. You can have your wife submit. And you can have your children know you're in charge, but are you the pastor? See, I'm here at Line of Judah 1, and I'm here at Line of Judah 2 for those that are watching. And I'm here because of my commitment. I'm here because of my responsibility. I'm here because of my joy and my delight. 30 years I've been here. That's a long time. This is the way Yahweh wants us to feel as husbands. I found a good thing, right? I sanctify her, set her apart. I'm in it for the long haul. Till death do us part. Or whoever kills who do us part. Listen, don't say you're the head if you can't be the pastor. Just because you say you are, you have to be the pastor. The word is serious about this. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Now, take in the context that I'm going to give it to you today. Let the wives remain silent when the congregation meets. They are certainly not permitted to speak out. Rather, let them remain subordinate, as also the Torah says. And if there is something they want to know, let them ask their own husbands at home. For it is shameful for a woman to speak out in the congregational meeting. So if you put this in context, in those days you had one side that were women and one side that were men. And the men were the ones that were allowed to go to Torah school. They were taught the Torah. The women were not. They were taught how to take care of the men, correct? So they were both commanded to come to the synagogue. So when they both were coming to the synagogue, the women over here, the preacher or the rabbi was actually speaking sometimes over their heads. They didn't understand what they were saying. So women would kind of say, "Honey, what they saying?" And what does Paul say? Let's not do that. Let's not do that. And in fact, me being your rabbi, I'm going to tell you, wives, whatever you do not understand, you go home to your rabbi and ask him, and he will what? He will get you to understand it, which means they have to know something. Hello? You know what's tiresome? Men, women being more spiritual than you. Go to your mom. She'll pray with you before you go to bed. Let your mom read it. Can you read a Bible? They need. Take them to church. Make sure they go to church. You're the pastor. Right? Listen, if you need a teacher, you're the teacher. None of us have all the answers. We get it. That's why you're here. You need a pastor. Our calling, our spiritual leadership calling, demands our best effort and attention. Don't expect your congregation at home to get with the program if you, as the pastor, hardly ever show up to the pulpit. You come here, and who do you expect to preach? Me. Sometimes I'm gone, and there's other people that preach, and that's just well and good. But when you came this morning, what did you expect? You expected me to come to the pulpit, deliver a word, right? And if I did not show up at the pulpit, the first time I say, "What's wrong? What's going on?" And you left, and there was no spiritual food, and no one knew what to do. And then you say, "Well, that's just, you know, happens one time." But then you keep coming back, and I'm not here, I'm not here, I'm not here, I'm not here, I'm not here. What are you going to do? You're going to find some place that has a shepherd, right? Because you need a shepherd. Husbands, be careful. Your wives need a pastor. They need a shepherd. If your wife has to go to the kehillah to find a pastor, and I'm saying this as a pastor, you are giving another man more influence over your wife and family than you have. I am supposed to be the pastor of all. I'm supposed to be the pastor of families. And yes, it also involves individuals. But women, your first pastor, if he has taken that role, is your husband. Not me. Men, don't get mad at me because your husband comes for your wife comes to me for the counseling because don't know what don't get mad at me because your wife comes to me for wisdom or understanding. Don't get mad at me because your wife has come to me for me to pray, because apparently there's lacking a pastor at the house. Oh, Lord. If your wife needs prayer, if your children needs prayer, who should pray first? Men, come on, who should pray first? If your wife has a problem, who should she be comfortable to go to? Her pastor first. Who's her pastor first? You are. How do you become that pastor? That means you're the one that's praying. You're the one that's reading. You're the one that's growing. You're the one that's worshiping. You're the one that's coming. Even if your wife doesn't want to come, you're coming. And you know what? When your wife says, I'm not going, and I'm keeping the children, you say, honey, you might not go, but I am going, and I will obey God, and my children and your children will come with me to the house of the Lord. We've sat back, and we're trying to figure out why things are happening and why we're not respected and why this is going on. It's because if there's no pastor in the house, it's important to have a pastor in this house, and I'm here, but you only come to me twice a week. Some of you just once a week. But if you're a pastor at your home, that's every day you have one. I'm not talking about someone who's just born again. Come on. The process of becoming less and less and more like Yahweh is what our mission is. Listen, as a man, we know how to point out the problem. But your wife needs a coach, not a critic. I know this might not be a good afternoon for some of you. And I get it. I understand it. I'm always leery. You know, when I preached on money, people got poor. Preached on relationships, things broke down. But shepherds lead his sheep. We don't drive them. Leading means that you are out front. Gail, come here for one second. If I'm leading you, you know, this is walking side by side. We get this. But if I need to lead her, I take a step forward. I'm leading her. And I would lead her through dangerous places. I would lead her through good places. You know what I'm saying? I'm leading her, which means I'm on out front. And I'm out front because I'm watching. I'm aware of what's going on. You know what I'm saying? If I want a worshiping wife, I need to be a worshiping husband. If I want a worshiping children, I need to be a worshiping father. If I want a wife that prays, I need to be a praying man. If I want a wife that loves God, I need to love him. I'm leading. She is not leading me. Well, whatever you think, honey. What do you want to pray? I don't know. What do you want to read? You got the children. You take care of the children. Whatever you want. You know. If she is sluggish at home and it's Saturday, I should be coming to her. Honey, come on. You ready to go to church? What's going on? Let's go to church. It shouldn't be. Oh, honey, I know you worked hard. Come on, you're not going to church today. But I really want you to go to church. The children want you to go to church. Come on, when? Maybe next week. I'm going to get rough here for a minute. Are you ready? Weak man. Weak man. I need a rose. My wife shouldn't be asking me, are you ready to go to church? Are you going to church? I should be asking them. That's my job. I'm a pastor of you, but I'm a pastor of her. I'm a pastor of my children. You can have a seat, hon, if you want to, unless you want to follow me around. That's okay, huh? You know, Paul said, imitate me as I imitate Yeshua, right? I should be looking at my wife, and I should be looking at my children and say, imitate me as I imitate Yeshua. Then together I should say, imitate to my children, imitate your mother and I as we imitate Yeshua. Why is it so hard? Maybe as men, we're just not growing or maturing. A husband who is stagnant spiritually is in no position to lead his wife. It's really hard to follow a parked car. It's really hard. None of you, unless there's some freak accident or I'm on the mission field, would ever have to ask Gil, where's your husband today? What's happened? Something going on? Why? Because I take the role of a pastor seriously. I'm not just talking about for the moment. I'm talking about for your children and the children's children. Come on. What's the results of a sanctification? Ephesians 5:27. In order to present the Messianic community to himself as a bride to be proud of, without a spot, without a wrinkle, or any such thing. But what? Holy and without defect. Wouldn't that be great to say that about our bride? She's holy and without defect. And your children, they're holy and without defect. They've been transformed by how? By the role of a pastor that you've taken in your life. This is not to upset you. It's not to make you mad. It's not to make you feel bad. It's to propel you forward. Come on. Listen, I can tell you, if you want me, I tell you all the faults that I have. And then if you really want more, Gail will tell you some faults. I probably would have to stop her for sake of time. I mean, how in the world can we create this sanctification? Well, first of all, you don't do it by yourself, right? And second of all, I think one of the reasons why we don't do it, and men, can I just say this to you? You don't realize the extent of the authority that Yahweh has given us in our marriages, in our homes. You don't understand the impact and the authority that God has given to you as a man. Can I show you? Give me 5 minutes. Good thing I took the offering up before the sermon. Look at Genesis chapter 2, 19 and 20. So from the ground, Adonai God formed every wild animal and every bird that flies in the air, and he brought them to the person to see what, read it with me, he would call them. Who named the animals? Who named the flowers and the trees? Who created everything? Who did God give authority to do? Name Adam. And whatever the person would call each living creature, that was to be its name. That's powerful authority. You know, God didn't interrupt and say, really, you're serious about that name? No, I give Adam the authority, whatever you name it. Name it a tiger to be a tiger. Name it a lion to be a lion. Whatever the person will call each living creature, that was to be its name. So the person gave names to all the livestock, to the birds in the air, and to every wild animal. But for Adam, there was not found a companion suitable for helping him. So Adam has authority, right? But he's lacking a companion. You know, just to stop here for a moment before we continue on, to name something is to have authority over it. Which is why Abram name was changed by God to Abraham. Who named him? Who has authority over Abraham? That's why it's very powerful in the Jewish community that when they become of age, bar bat mitzvah, they have a Hebrew name given to them, which means authority has changed. In Genesis chapter 1, 28, what's it say? It says, God blessed them. God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish in the sea, the birds in the air, and every living creature that crawls on the earth. You were supposed to have dominion. Go to Genesis 2, 22 and 23. The rib which Adonai God had taken from the person, which is Adam, he made a woman person, and he brought her to the man person. And the man person said, at last, this is bone from my bones and flesh from my flesh. She is to be called, who called her a woman? Adam. Adam had the authority and the dominion to name every animal and everything that was ever created by God. God pulls Eve, or Hava, out of Adam and then brings her to him, and it's his responsibility to what? To name her. She is to be called woman because she was taken out of man, which is why we have the Hebrew word for man, ish, and woman is isha, which means taken from man. So Adam named the animals, he named the trees, he named the flowers, he named everything, and he named his wife, woman, isha. Now, we might overlook that, but a wife taking her husband's name is far more than a legal move. It actually shows Yahweh's original intent in marriage. The original intent in marriage is that Adam would be the sanctifier, the savior, the covering, the spiritual one in that relationship. And she would come underneath his name, underneath his wings. And actually, it's the first act of submission that a wife performs for a husband. I now introduce to you Mr. and Mrs. Jeffrey L. Myers. From that moment forward, she used to be a galone. But when I pulled her out special to sanctify her, set apart, she's going to be so set apart that she is breaking from galone and becoming Myers. She's my special Isha. This is why the practice has fallen away. It's in such a disfavor that so many women will insist on going in the marriage 50-50. Well, I still want my last name in there. I want to hyphen my last name. And you might want to do that, and that's just, well, good and fine. But biblically, you're fighting against what a man's supposed to do for you. Why was Hava brought to the man? Because that man was to take dominion in his house with his wife and the children that he would have. But look at Genesis 3. Now the serpent was more crafty than any animal which Adonai God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you're not to eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman answered the serpent, "We may eat from the fruit of the tree of the garden, but about the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden, God said, you are neither to eat from it nor touch it, or you will die." The serpent said to the woman, "It's not true that you surely die, because God knows that on the day you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will become like God, knowing good and evil." Can I stop here for a moment? Where's Hava's pastor? Who did Hava make her pastor? The serpent. Why wasn't Adam her pastor? Because somewhere along the line, he didn't understand the authority and power of who he's been created to be. So she went to another pastor. There's no need to ask these questions when you have a pastor who has the answers for you. Right? The serpent said to the woman, "It's not true that you will surely die," verse 5, "because God knows that on the day you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." And when the woman saw that the tree was good for her food, that it had a pleasing appearance, and that the tree was desirable for making one wise, she took some of its fruit and ate. Read it with me. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Why is her pastor quiet? Why is that false pastor, false shepherd, false prophet able to speak into her life when her pastor is right there? Who's standing up for her and saying, no, you don't understand. She has my name. She will not listen to you, nor your words, nor your wisdom. I am her pastor. So I rebuke you. But apparently, somewhere along the line, they switched the role. And she became his Jezebel. And he became her Ahab. Because during this whole time of speaking, he says not a word. He is dependent upon her spirituality to get them through, and not what he knows to cover and sanctify her. To eat it, you have to pick it. Why didn't he stop her? She gave it to him to eat, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were open, and they realized that they were naked, so they sewed fig leaves together to make themselves loincloths. Men, if you're not your wife's preacher, pastor, somebody will. A friend will. A sister will be. She'll speak into your life things about your husband, and you'll start thinking Oprah will be. Dr. Phil will become. Well, I saw Dr. Phil, and he said, you don't love me. Does Dr. Phil know me? Come on. Now, I'm not saying that you are to be a tyrant, man, nor a dictator. Hello? But a loving spiritual leader whose purpose is to sanctify his bride. What Yeshua does for the Kehillah, a man is to do for his wife. Husband, you can enhance the process, or you can kill the process. Let me close with this scripture, 2 Corinthians 4:16 through 18. This is why we do not lose courage. Though our outer self is headed for decay, our inner self is being renewed daily. For our light and transient troubles are achieving for us an everlasting glory whose weight is beyond description. We concentrate not on what is seen, but on what is not seen, since things seen are temporary, but things not seen are eternal. I want my wife to change. Then become her pastor. Become her priest. Become her sanctifier. Young man, don't look for a woman just to satisfy your needs. Look for someone who understands, I want to be your sanctifier. I want to be the priest of the home. If she already has a Jezebel spirit, now's not the time to marry. Listen to me, man. We need to want this. It's easy just to let our wives drive. Just drive, whatever you want. Whatever your mother says. I don't want to go to church. Whatever your mother says. This is more honor, whatever your mother says. Do you know not only will a serpent come to your wife, but a serpent will come to your children? And if they don't have a pastor who leads, guides, worships, committed, and not afraid to say no and yes, they will eat from the same fruit. Remember when we read in Ezekiel, what did God say in Ezekiel? Listen, these things will happen and you will die. And he says, what? I take no pleasure in your death. I would rather that you live. And what did he say at the end? So make good choices and live. I want you to live. Do you understand? God wants you to live. God wants you to live. But we have to get a clean heart, clean life, so that it changes our wives, it changes our children, and it sanctifies our home. Listen, it's Mother's Day. We honor mothers. We honor women. But the greatest honor we can give our mothers and our women is if, as men, we become what we're supposed to be become. We can give them a flower, and that's nice. And you'll give them presents. Thank you for having my children. Here's a present. And that's all well and good. But if you ask them, really, they would just want you to be the strongest, most powerful, most anointed, most glorious and godly man in the whole entire world. That's all they really want. We just sometimes try to pay him off. Here's a present. If you think your wife's a Jezebel, look in the mirror first to make sure you're not an Ahab. Because a Jezebel can only flourish in a spirit of an Ahab. Men, it's a call to arms. It's a call to walk in your position for the sake of your wives and the sake of your children. Because we are living in the very last days. And they will need someone who will lead them, guide them, and direct them in the ways of God when all hell breaks loose. Come on. Are you hearing me, men? Who are the pastors at Line of Judah? Well, let me start counting the men. Who is the pastor at Line of Judah? Well, here I am. But how many pastors do you have? You know, people ask me that all the time. How many pastors? And I always say, you only have two, three, however. But I'm going to start saying, I'm going to count the men, and I'm going to start saying all of them. They'll probably be shocked. How many pastors you got? 30? How big a ministry you got? That's big enough for 30 pastors. Are they all paid? They get paid somehow. They do. They all have jobs. They get paid. Man, we should start looking at each other as pastors. How's your flock? Antonio, how's your flock doing? Benny, how's your flock doing? Or your chickadee doing? Pastor Kenny, how's your flock doing? Isaiah, I know you don't have a flock yet, so praise God. How's your flock? How you doing? You know, we have a men's meeting coming up, and that's one of the most important things as men. Sometimes we haven't done it well. We don't do it sometimes. But we need to be better because it needs to be pastors coming together. Pastors coming together for the sake of their flocks. Amen. Pastors, I love you. I'm going to put my paddle away now. But my daddy and my mother beat me. No, I shouldn't say that because that's not true. When I disciplined my children, gave them a moment, then always came in and said, I love you. Didn't help them at the moment. Helped me to know that what I did, I still love. I love you. I love you. Amen. Father, we thank you and we praise you. We worship you and we magnify your name. We give you praise and we give you honor. Now, no one's looking around. No women are looking around. No children are looking around. No men are looking around. Just let me ask this to the men. Men, can you at least admit there's room within you to grow from a Christian worker to a pastor? That you need to step up your game and to be able to sanctify your wife and your children. If that's you and you're willing to, in the process of transformation, not asking you to be perfect overnight. I'm just asking. You're acknowledging, I need to step up my game. I need for my wife to understand I'm a sanctifier. I need to be more what God wants me to be as a man, as the pastor of my house. And I'm willing to be the pastor of my house. And I will allow the Spirit of God, the Ruach HaKodesh, to lead me, guide me, and direct me. But I will do all I can to change. If that's you, just lift your hand real quick. Just lift your hand real quick. Let's just stand before we call the women up. Let's just all of us stand and lift our hands. And let's sing I Surrender All. To thee, my freely give, and I will ever trust you in His presence daily. Women, could you come, please? All women and mothers, please come, because we honor women also. Someone can move this pulpit for me. I appreciate that. As the women come and line up, I need some pastors to come and stand beside me. Some pastors, please come and stand beside me. I remember the sermon, so that should be somebody. All pastors, come and make a line beside me to my left and to my right. How you doing, Pastor? How you doing, Pastor? Nice to have you. How you doing, Pastor? 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 How you doing, little Pastor? Coming up. Don't cry. It's okay. How you doing, Pastor? Your dad's more scary than I was ever. How you doing, Pastor? How you doing, Pastor? Women, we love you. Mothers, we appreciate you. We thank you for all that you do, because without you, really, this church would not function as it does. So we appreciate, all these pastors appreciate you. Thank you so much for your teaching, for your giving, for the time that you give, for over the years that you have given. Again, we so much appreciate you. And we thank you that you are powerful handmaids of the Lord, powerful women of God. Some starting out, some been for a while, but from the bottom of our hearts, we thank you. We look at you. Pastors, look at them in their eyes and just, everyone just say thank you. Thank you to my wife for being a powerful wife and a powerful mother to our children. And to all the moms. I know sometimes your children don't make it easy, but it doesn't go unnoticed by Adonai. If you continue to do what God wants you to do, I guarantee your children are clean. They're clean. Might not look it, but they're clean. Sister Bertha, we love you. In fact, you are the youngest one here. You are the mother, and there's some young man behind you. I don't know who he is. Just some stranger coming. You've always picked up stranger, haven't you? My Lord, help us all. Sister Bertha, can you just come here for a minute and stand here? Because we just want to honor you. You know, when you have been going through a lot of those times of struggle, you know, the Lord spoke and said he was going to increase your years, and he's increased your years. And we appreciate it so much. We don't say it enough that we appreciate you. Ashley, get that wrap. We want to do something. Come sit down for a minute. Turn around, look at the women. Turn around right here and sit down. This, not on a chair, right here. Woo, woo. Listen to your pastor. You ain't got one except me. You're a powerful woman. And so I ask Ashley if she would come and wrap this around your head like they do in Africa. And we want to give you this. Olivia, can you come and open this up and put this around Sister Bertha? Let her open it first, then you can do it. We're wrapping this because we just want you to know you are a woman of wisdom and that you have covered us so many times. Even me sometimes. Pastor, what are you doing? Why are you doing that? So from our family, we just want to just honor you. There you go. With this bracelet.
You've taken me from the miry clay. You set my feet upon a rock.
You don't mind if we take time,
now
do you?
I know.
You got it, girl, because I can't help you. I can't see nothing. Love you. Just passing these glasses.
And
we don't want to choke you.
My world may fall,
amen. We love you. Amen. Women, this is just one of the gifts that we have for you. Just if you just start here and then go down, start with Sister Bertha, let her pick her rose that she wants. Two of you can go in case one can hold, the other one can hand out. Sister Bertha, what color would you like? You want white? There you go.
Sister Bertha, and I've said this at the women's meetings many a time, she is an across-the-board equal opportunity, tell it to you. She has told my children, as children and as my adult children, she has told my grandchildren as she's told your grandchildren.
Amen. It's back. Let me lead you, honey. Does everybody have a rose? All right, Pastor, stretch forth your... Oh, yeah, I got this here. First of all, this is teacher appreciation. And I know there's a lot of you that are teachers, but there's one I just wanted to pick out special because she's been... dealing with the children for so long, and sometimes by herself, sometimes a big crowd, sometimes a lot of children, and we just appreciate Sharon. We appreciate you, Sharon. And so what we did was this. It says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. Thanks, Sharon. So for $19.95, you can have this. And then we have this this plaque that says, Sharon, with your name in Hebrew, means...
Is that his playing his song?
There it is in Hebrew. Bonnie and Benny got that together for us. Sister Bertha, you've been watching over our children, and you've been helping Sharon lately, so we got you this, a smaller one that you can put in your dashboard.
while you're driving. And then they also made you a plaque, Bertha. Bertha in Hebrew means bright. Bright. Amen. All right, pastor, stretch forth your hands to the women. Wherever your woman is, you can do it, or just stretch it forth. Move them around if you want. Father, in the name of Yeshua, we thank you for every woman, every mother that's represented in this place. Father, we ask for your anointing. We ask, Father, for your love and your grace and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for their desires to come into fruition. We thank you, Lord, that we will become, and even those that are not here, that we will become the pastors that they desire. Father, Lord, let us, Father, be what you want us to be. Father, even some fathers and husbands that are not here, Father, reach out and, Father, prick their hearts. And Father, Lord, just bring these women to a place where they are so honored in their relationship. Those who are not married, let them wait to find that one that will honor them, Father. But, Lord, we ask for your anointing. We ask for your grace. We ask for your mercy. We ask for your empowerment to be upon them, Father. And we thank you that you have brought them to this house. And we honor them, Father, in this place today, Father. As you honor them, Father, we give you praise. Bless them, multiply them, anoint them, Father. In the name of Yeshua we pray. Amen and amen. We love you. We love you.
And I need you. And though my world may fall, I never let you go. You're my Savior, my closest friend.
Hold on, women, I want to hug you.
And I will worship.
I know the men won't hug me after the sermon, but it's all right.
Until the very end. Cause I love you. And I need you. And though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. You're my Savior, my closest friend. And I will worship you until the very end. Yeshua, you're the lover of my soul.
Come on, children.
Yeshua, I will never let
all children
you
come
go.
For a prayer before we go eat.
Woo. You've taken me from the miry clay.
Okay, I need pastors.
My feet upon a rock. And now I know, I love you, and I need
I know we're a little bit late, but we're all right.
And
all the children underneath here, pastors, men, women, holding a prayer shawl if you want to. Father, right now we just thank you for these children. We ask God that you anoint them, watch over them. Father, I thank you, Lord, that there are those that are Rebecca's and Sarah's and Leah's and Rachel's, Father, those who are Ephraim's and Manasseh's and Joseph's and Peter's and Paul's, and just great men and women of Adonai who are serving you with all their heart. Bring them to the saving knowledge of you, the Messiah. Let them be guarded by your word. Father, I thank you, Lord, that they will heed the words of you, and Father, walk in the ways that, Lord, will make them powerful, and that they call them to be missionaries and pastors and teachers and prophets and evangelists and just great men and women of God, Father, to serve you. Watch over them. Guard them. Father, we anoint them and consecrate them again to you in this place and in this house. And we thank you and praise you. In the name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen and amen. Go ahead, Pastor Kenny. If you can, do the priestly blessing. If not, I'll just say it in English. Okay, you got it. Let's lift our hands to receive the priestly blessing before we go into the fellowship hall.
Yevarechecha Adonai Veish Merech.
Zichunecha Yesa
Yahweh, he who exists, kneel before you presenting gifts and will guard you with a hedge of protection. And Yahweh, he who exists, will illuminate the wholeness of his being towards you, bringing order, and he will provide you with love, sustenance, and friendship. And Yahweh, he who exists, will lift up wholeness of being and look upon you. He will set in place all you need to be, both whole and complete. May Yahweh grant all the desires of our hearts, fulfill all our purposes and all our petitions. May Yahweh hear from heaven, quickly answer all our requests, and save us in the day of adversity. And in the name of Yeshua the Messiah, defend us from our enemies, from poverty, and from bondage. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom, everyone. See you all in the fellowship hall. Ladies, all ladies, whether you're a mother or a woman, can sit in that row that we have created for you. Men, just sit in the round tables, and we'll see what's going to happen here in a minute.